वेलकम टू स्मार्ट न्यूज़ डिजिटल August 6, 2018. सो टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू सी ऑल दीस आर्टिकल्स. सो द फर्स्ट आर्टिकल इज लॉन्च ऑफ इंडियाज सेकेंड मून मिशन इज पोस्टपोन. सो द चंद्रयान 2 इज द इंडियाज सेकेंड मून मिशन. सो इट वॉज एक्चुअली सपोज टू बी लॉन्च एट अप्रैल दिस ईयर, देन इट गॉट पोस्टपोन टू अक्टूबर, बट नाउ दे आर सपोज टू लॉन्च एट जैन 2019. सो वाई? बिकॉज दे आर कंसिडरिंग द सेटबैक्स और द इसरो सेटबैक्स विच वॉज प्रीवियसली फेस्ड. वन इज द GSAT-6A विच इज अ मिलिट्री कम्युनिकेशन सैटेलाइट. सो दिस GSAT-6A लॉस्ट द कम्युनिकेशन फ्रॉम द अर्थ स्टेशन. सो इट इज अ फेलियर, इट इज अ फर्स्ट फेलियर बाई इसरो. सो सिमिलरली PSLV C-39 mission, which is to launch this IRNSS-1H, which is our country's own GPS system, it is also not that much successful. Why? Because the heat shield is refused to open to launch the satellite. So considering these two setbacks by ISRO, now they are planning to launch this Chandrayaan 2 in a very careful or cautious way. So that is why this delay is. This is what the ISRO's head stated. So this Chandrayaan 2, see here, so this is, it contains a lander, orbiter, as well as the rover. So this is the first mission of our country to land this rover on any celestial body, which is in this case moon. So now we are planning to land this rover on the moon surface, especially to explore the south pole of the moon, right? So it is to explore that this Chandrayaan 2 is aimed at. So this lander, orbiter, as well as the rover, everything is developed by India itself, and it is going to be get launched by GSLV Mach 3 rocket. Okay. So the second article is Jammu Kashmir tense ahead of SC hearing on Article 35A. So today Supreme Court is going to hear the cases whether this Article 35A is constitutional or not. So what is the issue? Now we are going to see that. So we all know that Article 370, it provides special status to Jammu and Kashmir. Similarly, this Article 35A, it empowers the Jammu Kashmir state legislatures to define the permanent residence of Jammu and Kashmir. So, which means whoever the permanent residents of Jammu and Kashmir, they have certain special rights and privileges like employment, acquisition of immovable property in Jammu and Kashmir, settlement in J&K, and right to scholarships and aids from the government institutions. So these are all only provided to the permanent residents of Jammu and Kashmir and not to any outside people or outsiders of Jammu and Kashmir. So this permanent residence is only be defined by the state legislature of Jammu and Kashmir. This is what defined under Article 35A. So if you see the implementation of this Article 35A, then it is added into the constitution through a presidential order by Dr. Rajendra Prasad with the advice of Union government under Jawaharlal Nehru in 1954. Okay. So it is not following any procedures that should be followed by the parliament in order to add this 35A into the constitution. So Article 370 also, it is also not conferring any power to the president so that he could amend the constitution on his own. But this Article 35A is added into the constitution through presidential order. So this is what the issue is. So as this inclusion of Article 35A into the constitution is not held according to the procedure established by the parliament, so now what the issue is, whether it should be held constitutional or unconstitutional. So let's see what the Supreme Court decides on this issue. So the third article is amendments to the Motor Vehicles Act. So this Motor Vehicles Act 1988 is very old or archaic, and it also doesn't have the provisions to manage the fast motorization which has taken place in our country. So in order to adopt to the changing nature of our transportation system in our country, certain amendments has to be made in this Motor Vehicles Act. So this is what the recent news is. The states have to acknowledge that this amendment of Motor Vehicles Act will result in benefit to everyone. So what they actually meant here is to, under this amendment, to improve the road safety, ensure the orderly use of the vehicles, and expand the public transportation in our country. These are the aims of this new amendment. So as we know that this motor vehicles or this transportation is under the concurrent list, both the center as well as the state can have the rights to make the laws over this. So now the center is planning to form a national transportation policy with the consultation from the states, not with the concurrence with the states. So this is what a major concern. The states think that this might be being an anti-federal in nature. And we also know that these state-run services are not kept pace with the times. So if we see in case of example, major investment has been done in this urban metro system, metro rail systems and all, but it is not yielding that much greater result. It is yielding poor results because of the lack of last mile connectivity. So in order to get this last mile connectivity, we need simple transportations like bus services and all. So, and it should also be under some regulatory mechanism. So if at all, for example, in case of Europe, they recently had done this regulatory changes to their transportation system. So this has yielded or fostered this competition among the transport service providers. It reduced the fares for the consumers as well as it increased the services and the quality of the services. So if we follow this similar thing, if we bring this regulatory mechanism for this Motor Vehicles Act, then we can also benefit all these things in our country. So under this Motor Vehicles Act, they actually plan to curb this institutionalized corruption. Only person to person contact can increase the corruption, right? So what they are planning to do here is, so under this new amendment, what they are aiming is the dealer should directly go to the office to register the new vehicles, and everything should be made online in from the getting the driving licenses till the registration. And if at all any violations is happening, then fine should be imposed on them, and CCTV monitoring should also be ensured in order to make this regulatory mechanism a worthy one. So in the states, in this case, should understand that it is not the shifting of the power from the states to the center. So now they have to realize this, and the center and the state should work in tandem to make this regulatory mechanism an effective one. So the next article is NCBC will get more powers. So by means of this 123rd Constitutional Amendment Bill, this NCBC, which is the National Commission for Backward Classes, is going to be changed as NSEBC, which is National Commission for Socially and Educationally Backward People. So as of now, we are having this NCBC. So what it usually does is it recommends the inclusion and the exclusion of the castes into the OBC list. This is one thing. And second major thing is it determines or it recommends the level of the income cutoff for the creamy layers. If you see here, the National Commission for Scheduled Castes. So as of now, it is only addressing the grievances of the OBCs. But if this SEBC is getting implemented, then it will take care of all those things regarding this OBC people. And so it would be redressing their grievances in case of any violences or in case of any reservations and all. So clause 3, subclause 5 deals with the power to this national commission to inquire into the compliance of deprivation of the rights and safeguard of the rights of this OBC people. So clause 3, subclause 8 gives this national commission the power of a civil court, which means it can try a suit, it summon the people, asks for documentation submission, and it calls for the evidences. So the fifth article is scheme for girl child launched in Bihar. So Bihar's chief minister recently launched this Mukhyamantri Kanya Uthan Yojana, which provides 54,100 rupees for each and every girl from the birth of a child till she graduates. So it is a major good move by the Bihar government. So it is going to be get implemented by three departments: education, health and social welfare. Similarly, he also assured that the sanitary napkins fund is to be increased from 250 rupees to 300 rupees by means of this Kishori Swasthya Yojana. As similarly, the amount allocated for bicycle is also getting increased from 2500 to 3000 rupees. So the next article is corrupt government officials will be able to escape public scrutiny. So Justice Sri Krishna panel recently drafted this Personal Data Protection Bill 2018, and they, under this draft, what they actually wanted is they want to amendment Section 8 of the RTA Act, which is information to be exempted. So under this Sri Krishna panel, what they wanted is to amend the Section 8 of the RTA Act. So this Section 8 of the RTA Act is the information to be exempted from the disclosure. If you want some kind of information from the government, so what are the informations that are not given to you based on this RTA Act? So that is what this article deals with. So under this new amendment, what they telling is personal data, which is to cause harm to the data principal, who are the people who are giving the data to the public companies or the private companies or whatever. So we are the data principal. So where such harm outweighs the public interest in accessing such information to the common good of promoting transparency and accountability in the functioning of the public authority. So what they are telling here is, if the personal data of a person outweighs the public interest. It is very important or sensitive, which is more outweighs the public interest, then those kind of information should not be disclosed under this RTA Act. So this is what they are proposing in this new amendment. But the present Chief Information Commissioner raised a concern about this, stating that this Justice Sri Krishna panel is not consulting with the Chief Information Commission while proposing or asking for this amendment, as well as this expand the scope of denial of information. If you go and ask for the information, they can easily deny the information, stating that it is a personal data, so we should not disclose. So this is a major concern, and it also make the government officials more corrupt, and they can easily escape from the public scrutiny if at all the information is denied by means of this RTA Act. So the next article is anatomy of an outbreak. This article deals about the Ebola virus. So what the news here is, the Congo learned from 2014 Ebola crisis. So 2014 was a major outbreak in this West African country, especially this Congo, but now they learned a lot from that 2014 Ebola virus, and they take sufficient steps and they reduce the number of deaths due to this Ebola virus this year. So this is the news is. So now we are going to see what this Ebola virus is. So it is endemic to West African countries. It is a rare and deadly disease which is affecting both the people and non-human primates. And this Ebola virus was first discovered in 1976 near the Ebola River, which is now called as Democratic Republic of Congo. So the first case of this Ebola virus was recorded in, see here, this Guinea, and then later it started spreading to Sierra Leone and Liberia. So this is mainly due to four disease-causing viruses, which is combinedly called as Zaire virus. So if you see the transmission of this Ebola virus, so initially it is like the human infection is through the contact with an infected bat or other wild animals, and then it later spread from human to human also. So if a person is getting affected with this Ebola virus, then it can easily get transmitted from person to person by means of blood, saliva, as well as the sexual transmission, as well as through sexual transmission. So this, what are the symptoms for this Ebola virus in the sense? The sudden influenza-like illness, which is characterized by feeling tired, fever and pain in the muscles and the joints, and headache, nausea and abdominal pain, as well as severe vomiting and diarrhea. So these are the symptoms of Ebola virus. And as of now, there is no approved vaccine or treatment for this Ebola virus diseases. So we have to take some precautionary steps in order to control this Ebola virus. The next article is the problem at the WTO, which is World Trade Organization. And this article also tells about how the emerging economies like China, India should play a vital role in shaping this multilateral organizations. So if you see here, the US has long been proven an isolationist in this WTO because they systematically blocked the appointment of new judges in the appellate body of WTO. So the other WTO members are raising concern over this politicization of the US in the appellate body appointment and reappointment process of WTO. So not only this WTO, US is also following its protectionism by means of criticizing this NAFTA, which is North American Free Trade Agreement, and TPP, which is Trans-Pacific Partnership. So they are US is criticizing these multilateral institutions, and they also want to come out of these institutions. So these all shows that the US first gaining from the globalization, but now they are trying to follow protectionism. In order to combat this unilateralism and protectionism, which is followed by the developed countries, in order to combat that, in order to protect the rules-based WTO system, and in order to ensure the reforms which should be taken place in this WTO, what we need to do is, that is, the time has come for the emerging economies like China, EU, as well as India to have a greater say in shaping this multilateralism and its institution, and they should have a vital role in shaping these WTO as well as other multilateral institutions. Thank you.